Maryann Sasaki. Welcome to Life in the Law on Wednesdays from 1 to 2 at thinktechhawaii.com. We're so lucky today. We're so lucky to have Brandon Elefante, a councilman for the city council. He's taken time out of his busy day to talk to us, and I have 100 questions for him, so we better get started. So welcome, Brandon.
Welcome. Thank you for having me, Maryann.
Oh, I'm so glad you came.
Pleasure to be on your show.
So I did... You know, I'm new to Hawaii, so you have to forgive me. So I know that you're the councilman for Ever Beach, Pearl City, and Aiea? Am I right?
Close.
Okay.
So Pearl City, Aiea, and Waipahu.
Waipahu.
Yeah.
Okay. And what district is that?
That is District 8 on
oh,
the City
okay.
Council.
It's yes. District 8. And well, let's talk a little bit about you because,
sure.
you know, you're young, you're upcoming. So tell me a little, you grew up in Hawaii?
I did, yes. So I was born and raised here on Oahu
mm-hmm.
and attended public schools throughout my life.
Terrific.
My mother was a single mother, so I never met my father growing up. So my mother had me at a very young age, at the age of 20. And as the saying goes, you know, it takes a village to really raise someone. It really took a village, my family and aunties and uncles and lots of people to help support me and help raise me and ensure that I had a good education as well as the moral support and love from my family.
That's terrific.
So I thank them each and every day. My grandparents are still around. They're in their 80s. I live with them.
And oh, terrific.
Kind of like an age and place for them. And, you know, they're part of the boomer generation or actually
right.
past that. And so I attended public schools throughout my life and went on to college on the mainland.
Where'd you go?
St. Mary's College of California.
Okay.
That's in the San Francisco Bay Area. It's a small liberal arts school. For those that are watching, you probably may know of Herman Wiedemeyer, a great football player known as the Flying Hawaiian back in the 40s.
I'm sure everybody knows, but I couldn't name a New York football player, let alone a Hawaiian football player.
But he was an All-American, and he attended the same college that I attended and graduated from. And shortly thereafter, I returned home. I thought I would stay on the mainland for quite some time, but there was an urging and calling for me to come home.
Oh.
And that's when I started to come back home and enrolled in graduate school and graduated from Chaminade, University of Honolulu.
Oh, terrific.
And finished my MBA in 2011.
Oh, I want to go for my MBA.
Oh, yes,
yeah.
You should.
I should, I know.
It's a wonderful experience. You learn a lot and you get to meet wonderful people.
Yeah, you get a cohort and you, yeah.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
And I still keep in touch with a lot of my MBA classmates to this day.
I was planning to go in September, but now I'm very, very busy at work. I don't know if I'll be able to go. This will be news to some of my office mates, some of my colleagues, but we'll see.
Well, it's night classes. You can go part-time. Chaminade's a good program.
Yeah, I can go part-time.
Yeah.
So did you always want a career in public life, or did that come to you after you were in school or when you came back?
Well, actually, growing up, and I was just sharing this with fourth and fifth graders at Career Day about a month ago at my alma mater, Webling Elementary in Aiea, and I said, you know, growing up, I actually wanted to be a pilot.
Oh, well, that's exciting.
And I was really into that, you know, and, you know, just learning and looking at the different planes, even drawing in. And when I got in the cockpit of flying with one of my buddies who's a pilot, I says, yeah, there's no way I can be a pilot. There's
really?
A lot of responsibility
Too much
involved.
Pressure,
and you really have to enjoy it. So
right.
I decided to pursue other interests. Right. So I started off my career actually as a teacher. Thought I would love getting into that or working in higher education as well, and found that it wasn't quite the right fit for me. And looking back and thinking about where I've come from growing up as a child here in Hawaii and seeing the activities I was involved in as a child, getting involved with community organizations as well as student government, I said, you know, I ought to try that and
right.
see if that's something worthwhile doing for a career. And so that's what I did.
So how long did you teach?
I only taught for a year.
You taught for a year mm-hmm. and then you went on to do what?
After teaching, I moved back to the mainland.
Oh, wow.
A second time.
Good for you.
After college to see if I could work. So my background is in economics and business.
Mm-hmm.
And thought I could work for a corporate company in the San Francisco Bay Area. I mean, I just love the Bay Area.
It's
my
fantastic.
Home.
It's terrific. It's very expensive.
Smaller scale than Manhattan, where you're from. But
it might be more expensive to live there, actually,
right.
with all the dot, you know, web companies and, I don't know, what do you call them? They're not dot-com companies anymore. They're... electronic services companies?
Yeah, they're all a bunch of startups and right. different things.
That must have been very exciting, especially since you were in your 20s.
It was. Well, at the same time, when I got out of college, that's when we kind of had a recession.
Oh, yeah.
If well, you remember we that, subprime mortgages. Well. And so it was very difficult to find good jobs right. that I could see myself being a part of a company.
Right.
And so I actually really hit rock bottom. I remember walking into the unemployment office here locally and just really going through that experience of what it really felt like, you know, to be here with a college degree, walking to an unemployment office, asking for government assistance and help.
I think that's really important, and I really think that's important for people to hear too, because I've been on unemployment myself, mm. and it happens. People,
yes.
Life is bumpy. It's not a smooth, mm-hmm. it's not a smooth ascent, you know. And now, look, you're a councilman. I'm a practicing attorney.
Yeah.
We've been able to be resilient, and resilience is very, very important. So, if you're sitting at home and you're watching this and you're feeling, oh well, you know. I'm broke and I have to get a job. You can and you will. You will. So, but that's a great, I think that's great to share with your constituency because they know you're one of them.
And thank you for sharing that. You know, I did not know that as well. And, you know, life sometimes takes a turn.
Yeah, well, this recession of 2009 mm-hmm. was very hard for me too. Mm-hmm. So many people in New York weren't working. And, you know, people are still feeling the effects of the recession
Absolutely.
Of 2009. I mean, some people are doing well, and we have to help the others
Absolutely.
That aren't.
And we haven't fully recovered
no.
yet as well. And we see it, and we'll talk, I know, more in this show about policy issues that we're dealing with,
right.
you know, that we face day-to-day on a day-to-day basis. But, yes, it's about believing in yourself. And
right.
that's when I said, you know, I really want to work in public policy and really be a servant to the people.
That's terrific. So you went for it.
And I went for it, yes. My former predecessor, my boss, my predecessor, he's now a state senator, Senator Breen Harimoto. I worked under him for 4 years, and I consider him a very close friend and mentor. And our thoughts and prayers are with him as he continues to battle pancreatic cancer.
Oh, yes, I just read mm-hmm. about him. Oh, okay, yes, absolutely.
But he is strong-spirited. He has positive outlook on life, and I know he's recovering. He just completed his radiation as from what I heard, but we are keeping him in his thoughts and
yes,
prayers. And
absolutely.
I learned a great deal working under him.
What a wonderful mentor he must have been.
He is, and he still is till this day. And he's just a remarkable person that truly values principles, you know, of integrity, responsibility, transparency. And those are things that I've had in me that has given me hope in seeing an elected official.
That's so interesting that you say that because, first of all, people don't often speak about integrity and
mm-hmm.
hope. And would you say that those values are key for young, you know, like I said to you, I'm fascinated by the millennials. I'm fascinated because life really gave them a raw deal. They went to school, there was a recession. My generation, spent money and did all kinds of things, harmed the environment. Now they're here and they have to clean it all up. So would you say those values are particularly important to millennials, do you think?
Yeah, values of those values I did mention, mm-hmm. as well as other values too, and being a good steward of looking at our resources, whether they may be environmental, financial, or just taking care after one another. There's a strong sense from millennials that they really want to do good and really want to volunteer.
Right.
It's a lot of hours that millennials put into and putting in That's volunteering
great to hear.
Efforts. Yeah.
That's terrific to hear. And, you know, they are such a cohesive group. As I mentioned, I went to a conference this morning with respect to millennials, and millennials rely on each other for information. And so because it was talking about how do you reach out to millennials, how would you market to a millennial? Well, they rely on their friends. So they don't go and watch a TV commercial and go and buy a product. They ask all their friends, like, what are you doing? What's the best, you know, whatever. I do it myself on Facebook. I say, you know, should I buy these shoes or should I buy those shoes? And I put pictures of my shoes up or something like that.
Yes, they do rely on that. You are correct, Maryann. And more importantly, they also rely on social media.
Right.
Which is a really, really big thing. I think the how the World Wide Web, the internet, has transformed over the years to make it really accessible to find research and do things and communicate with people has made it more effective.
So could you tell our audience what kinds of social media where they can find you?
Sure. Facebook is one area they could look into. Twitter, Instagram, there's also Snapchat, also just a regular website. LinkedIn is another key area, but Facebook seems to be the way to go, you know, with businesses for personal pages and whatnot.
So look for Brandon on Facebook and, you know, like his page and maybe, you know, write him a little note. Maybe he'll, I know you'll write back because one thing about Hawaii that is so different than New York is that you can reach out to the legislators and they'll answer you.
Mm-hmm.
They, you know, it's a very small place and people
it is.
Are very, involved with each other, so
it's
I
very
think that's
sense of ohana here that
right.
you probably are finding is
right.
that there's connections that go down generations. And for me, I like to personally read every email. So every email that comes in,
good.
I personally read that, and we do our best to respond in a timely manner. And if I can't personally get back, then someone from my staff will. But it's yes, it's. I mean, you find out these different connections. It's so interesting to see who's connected to who,
right.
and the history
right.
behind all that.
Like you and I are connected to a colleague at work, and I also know your uncle Willis Barra. So it's definitely a small community.
Yes, it is.
I would like to say if anybody would like to call in and ask Brandon a question, they could call our hotline at 415-871-2474. I'll say that once more. 415-871-2474. So if you're in his district or not in his district and you have a question, give us a call. So tell me about your district. What's it, you know, I don't drive, so I don't get around much. So tell me what's it like and what kinds of issues are facing your district?
Yeah, I represent a very fantastic district. It stems from Waipahu all the way to Aiea. Each council district is about 100,000 people. There are 9 council members. I'm one of 9 on the council. And each of these communities are very distinctly diverse,
mm-hmm.
as well as different from each other. But there's a lot of core values that they also share too. It's a very aging population, especially in Aiea, Pearl City, and Waipahu, I should say, all 3 communities.
Right.
And there's also some young families that are starting up, you know, whether that may be in the Waipio area or Pearl City, multi-generational families.
Right.
I'm a product of the community being raised in the Aiea Pearl City area. I currently live in Pearl City.
Right.
So I've seen the changes over the years. For many others, they've seen it growing from a plantation town. Aiea had a sugar mill town. Waipahu
wow.
was a plantation town.
We're so close to those times, right?
It
really,
was sugar
it's
cane
been, really,
fields.
It's really...
Yes, sugar cane fields in Pearl City, and that has dramatically changed over the years and over decades. And now we're building a rail project that's coming to the heart of the district.
You know, and everybody knows I support the rail project because, you know, I know it can be great. I know it's a pain in the neck. I know it's over budget. I know all the problems. But Hawaii, once you have a rail system, you'll never want to go back. You'll never want to drive anywhere. You'll always want to take the train.
And I agree with you too, Maryann, and having traveled to other municipalities,
right.
and seeing how accessible it can be. And looking back, and when you talk to people that live in communities, whether they be maybe the San Francisco Bay Area or New York or Boston, one of the oldest rail transit systems, you wonder, how did they do it before this was built?
I know.
Which is really remarkable.
It is remarkable. We're going to take a quick break,
sure.
and we'll be back with more with Brandon Elefante on Life in the Law.
Hi, I'm Donna Blanchard. My show on ThinkTech is Center Stage. I interview artists of all different ilk on the show, and we talk about what they do and how they do it. Those are both really fascinating. What I find most fascinating about all of my interviews is talking to people about why they do what they do, what the process does for us, what the actual artistic process is. I hear all the time from people that they watch the show and they feel inspired. My guests tell me a lot that they feel inspired to go home and create something new and exercise, flex that artistic muscle. And I hope you will too. I hope you'll join us on Wednesdays at 2:00 on the ThinkTech Hawaii Digital Series.
Well, Welcome back. I'm Maryann Sasaki. I'm here with Brandon Elefante, and we're talking about politics and public service and how somebody so young got to be a city councilman. Did you have any age discrimination when you ran? Did you have to explain away that I'm really capable? You really want me? Were some people suspicious or you know?
Well, yeah, when I was going door to door, that was the number one question. How old are you?
Right.
Well, old enough to vote
and old
enough to run.
Right, right.
And when I would engage with them in discussion, as we would get to the issues, then they would understand. But that would be the number one question. And I still get that to this day.
I think you'd want a young, energetic person for council. It's certainly not for the lethargic, you know. So now, you said your district is an aging population. Now, Hawaii has, I think, the highest group of aging people over 80 in any of the states. I think it's fascinating. I think it's a great thing, actually, because I love seeing the mix here of older people and children, and as you said, Ohana. Are there services? Are you interested in bringing more services, or are there governmental services that the elderly or senior citizens, I should say, can avail themselves of there?
Yeah, absolutely. And what's really fascinating is the city and county of Honolulu, under the Department of Community Services, has an elderly affairs division.
Oh, terrific.
And each year they publish a book that has all the different types of services from police, fire, medical, or just simple stuff, where to file your real property tax, where to send it, just general information that's very helpful for them or if they need assistance in other areas. So there is an elderly affairs division within the city that does provide services to our elderly and kapuna.
That's great. Mm-hmm. That's great. Great. Because that is one of the foremost questions of the going forward. Our population is going to be aging, people are living it longer, and they want to live their lives as fully as they can, and they are. I know I have friends that are 80, 90 years old, and I had some of them on the show, and I was like, how do you do it? It's like, it's terrific. You know, they play tennis, and so it's wonderful. So now, what's going on in the legislature? What can you tell me? Some inside scoops or some legislation that you're particularly supportive of? Or
sure, yeah. So the city council is year round, so we have a year round calendar. Very different than Congress or our state legislature. Our state legislature is in session from January till about early May. They have to be in session for X amount of days as required. But for us, it's year-round. So we meet monthly, once a month, is our regular full council meeting. And coming up next week, Wednesday, June 1st, we will be voting on final reading, last and third final reading, on our city budget, which includes operating, capital, as well as many other things. Real property tax, I'm happy to announce that there are no increases in real property tax.
No increases in real property tax.
So,
yes.
And that is our major source of revenue for the city and county of Honolulu. And we operate on billions of dollars in terms of our budget, operating and capital.
You know, your NBA must come in handy when you have to review the budget, I'm sure.
It is very helpful, and I'm very thankful for the wonderful staff that I have, very dedicated and loyal staff, because without them, I would not be able to address all these issues, and they're very helpful. So
I'd like to give a shout out to Jan. Is it Jan?
Jan Salcedo,
yeah,
yes,
Jan,
my secretary.
Thank you so much for all your help. You know, I called you a number of times, and you've been delightful and thoughtful a number of times. So thank you, Jan, from me personally to you.
Yes, and she is a gem, as well as Dion, Mary, Trisha, and April, and my staff. So I have a team of 5, 6, including me. And they really assist me with doing research and dealing with constituent calls, as well as making sure that I'm on schedule with my appointments and meeting and really diving into the issues. So I'm very thankful to all of them.
I don't know. You can tell me if you don't want to talk about this or you do want to talk about this. Would you like to talk about the presidential election? Do you have opinions? Or are you, as many politicians, not neutral at this point still?
Right. And, you know, it's always an interesting process. I think this year we see candidates for our presidential election. City council is nonpartisan, although I am a Democrat.
Oh, okay.
So
I do want to see. I know, because you're so
nice. Do want to see a Democratic president in the White
right.
House, and to continue on the mission and policies of the Democratic Party.
Right. Well, it looks like that may very well occur. Although I'm personally astounded that Donald Trump has gotten as far as he's gotten. I mean, I grew up with him in New York, so mm-hmm. it's almost like somebody saying, oh, Santa Claus wants to be president. I mean, it's like that unlikely. Mm-hmm. That's how mm-hmm. unlikely mm-hmm. it is for me, you know. It's really stunning. So with all this working, so do you have time? Do you have a life-work balance, or are you working? I bet you're working all the time, aren't you?
No, it's important to have a balance. It does feel like I'm working all the time. But I really enjoy what I do. And part of having a balance is, you know, I can be really flexible with my schedule. It's not a typical 8-to-5 job. This morning we were at a 6th grade promotion. You could say it's a graduation
oh,
for
sure.
them. Going on to middle school.
That's
so we're
a big
at that.
Step.
And tomorrow we'll be at another 6th grade graduation in Waipahu. My staff and I will be out there supporting them. So it's different. It's never an 8-to-5 sitting in a cubicle in an office. It's really dynamic in meetings and looking at it and voting on issues or going to different events and talking to people. And that's what I really enjoy, is really hearing from the community.
That's really hard. I think that's really hard to do all day, every day. It's really very draining. I mean,
it can be, yes. And it's good to know that in the role that I sit, I'm very honored and privileged to hear their concerns. And I understand that I can't satisfy or please everyone.
Right.
However, I can do my very best
right.
to ensure that their voice is heard and to ensure the best possible solution
That's great.
For the community.
And it's super important to seniors. I have to say that my mother is a senior citizen in New York, and Anthony Weiner actually was her congressperson. And he would come to the senior citizens groups and talk to them and bring them cookies and stuff like this. And she really still remembers him. I mean, it really made a huge impact. So, you know, your appearances are making a huge impact on people's lives. They're going to remember that, you know, forever, really, that you attended their promotion or you attended their, you know, whatever event you attended. People know who are genuine and who are quality. And they remember that, despite whatever the ups and downs of politics,
right,
you know, may
yeah.
be. But they, my mother is loyal. I have to say, she's super loyal. So, let's see. What should we talk about?
Well, we can talk about city issues for those that may not. If it's okay with you, Maryann, talk
yes,
about how
I'm
the
asking.
City functions and
oh, absolutely, because
city council. Because a lot of people, they get confused, like, oh, are you a state
educate
official?
Educate me.
Right, so the city council, we're the legislative arm, and the executive arm would be the mayor, which
okay.
is Mayor Kirk Caldwell.
Okay.
And we provide the check and balance.
Mm-hmm.
They're the executive, we're the legislative side. So we enact laws. And a lot of the city ordinances deal with just common things that a lot of people just take for granted. So picture this, right? When you woke up this morning, probably one of the first things you did is maybe brush your teeth, turn on the water, take a shower, use the restroom. Well, all that is all a work from government.
Right.
Sewer lines, water lines
right.
from the border water supply. When you get out on the street driving into work, or if you take public transportation, riding on the city bus or handy van, whatever the case may be, the roads, core services, those are all city functions. And so our role is to ensure that we have adequate funding to ensure that the people's wealth, health, and welfare is met.
Right.
And
right.
the city has grown substantially since our first city charter, which kind of is our governing document that sets the context for what
right.
we do.
Right.
And as I mentioned earlier, real property taxes are number one source of revenue that we get in order to employ people to do the work
right.
and restore whatever it may be, from traffic signals to road repairs, sewer lines, all of those
you
kind
need
of stuff.
It. I mean, you yes. need infrastructure. Everybody likes to drive on a road. Everybody has, you know, needs to go to school or this. These are all, you know, paid by our tax dollars. It's how a civilized society keeps itself operational, you know. So sometimes when I hear people griping about taxes, I'm like, that's just like the entrance, fare to civilized society. I mean, we really don't want to live in a place where there's no post office, no library,
right.
All these things we take for granted.
We do, and they're critical elements right. to how we carry out our lives every day.
Right. Absolutely. And you're an integral part of doing that, and I appreciate that because it is a service. I mean, you do have to listen to people's all the things people want, and you know, and really hear them, and so that's great. That's you know not easy. It's just not easy because people are so critical, can be so critical of politicians and so you know critical of government. But you know. Mm-hmm. Jay and I are both, we're the people. The government is the people. And, you know, you're the perfect example of people being able to be heard through an official, you know, that you answer their emails, so.
And I came from the community. It's, you know, I
that
have
must
this
be
privilege
huge.
To represent the community that I grew up in. And it's changing day by day.
What's that like? That must be. What kind of feeling is that like to grow up in a community and then represent them on the city council?
It's an awesome feeling. It really is. To the skill set that I learned being away from college and my experience that I have from traveling abroad and now being home, living with my grandparents who are in their 80s, really seeing them age in place. It's been a wonderful experience, and
they must
I look
be so proud.
To, They are. And they're very more active than I am, which is amazing.
I know. That's the thing that when I came to Hawaii, I couldn't, you know, I'd go to Costco or something, and there'd be these little ladies with these shopping carts, and they were fast, you know. They would, and I'd be like, Andrew's like, welcome to Hawaii. Yeah. You know, this is every, you know, people still running around and doing their thing, you know. So what would you say is some of the bigger issues facing the city? Obviously, we were talking about homelessness mm-hmm. earlier. Obviously, that's a big issue. Any solutions that you've seen or spoken about in terms of homelessness?
Yeah, so homelessness is a really near and dear issue to my heart. We are definitely in a homelessness crisis.
Yeah, it's a crisis, absolutely.
And when I first ran for office, I did talk about that as one of my agenda items that mm-hmm. I wanted to focus on. Mm-hmm. And we have not fully solved the problem. There's still issues involved with it. However, it's a multi-pronged approach to solutions that we have to do. And part of that is what I believe in is having a housing first approach, which is housing our most vulnerable population.
Right.
And in New York City, they you know started this program in other cities like Seattle and Denver and just other areas across the country. Really getting our most chronic to kind of stabilize them. And that's really
right.
the key,
right.
is to stabilize our most chronic homeless population.
Right. People don't realize that, you know, homelessness is often accompanied by various other problems, whether it's unmedicated mental illness mm-hmm. or a substance abuse problem. So you know, if you can get people in the stability of a house, there's more likelihood that they can get the services that they need. The services are there. It's not that the services aren't
right.
there. You know, it's just that it's getting them both to you know meet up.
Meet together, and absolutely. And now we have a way that we can coordinate services with our service providers and working with government entities and all stakeholders to ensure we provide those services to our homeless people, whether they may be living on the streets, along trails, under freeways, and really serve them. And one thing that I found interesting is that a nonprofit was at a homeless subcommittee meeting in Pearl City, and they shared with us that when they do outreach service, that ideally they would want kind of a low ratio from case manager to clients.
Right.
And right now,
oh,
based
sure
on their team of five,
right.
it's like 1 to 500.
Yeah, I'm sure.
That's really impossible to really cultivate relationships, build trust among our brothers and sisters who are homeless out on the street, and it's important to have and serve them in that capacity.
Right. I couldn't agree more. We're gonna continue talking about this issue because it's such an important issue. And I'm a big advocate also for blended housing, like communities. We have to welcome the homeless, low-income housing into our own communities. We can't close our eyes to this problem. So we're going to just take a break, and we're going to continue solving the world's problems right here on Life in the Law.
Hi, I'm Chris Leatham here with Think Tech Hawaii, and I invite you to watch my show, The Economy and You, each Wednesday at 3 o'clock here in Hawaii on OC16. We look forward to seeing you. Aloha.
Hello, I'm Crystal from Kwok Talk. I've got a new show here. You've got to tune in, check out my topics on sensitive, provocative female issues. So Tuesday mornings, 10 o'clock. Don't miss it. It's going to be fun and dangerous.
Aloha. My name is Richard Emery, host of Condo Insider. More than a third of Hawaii's population live in some form of association, and our show is all about educating board members and owners about their responsibilities and obligations and providing solutions for a great association. You can watch me live on Thursdays, 3 p.m. to 4 p.m. each week. Aloha.
Hi, I'm Maryann Sasaki. I'm with Brandon Elefante. We're discussing problems municipalities face, particularly our own, Honolulu. And we were just talking about homelessness and poverty, actually. And, we were talking a little bit in the break about how, you know, there are working people who still can't afford their own homes. I mean, they go to work 5 days a week and you know, I don't know what the solution to that is, if it's an increase in the minimum wage or a reduction in taxes for people, or how do we get more people, you know, working and in, you know, living in homes and living their lives?
Well, we have to create opportunities for people, as we were previously talking about. For a lot of people, it could be multiple factors on why they are homeless.
Right.
And some they choose not to be, some they do. But part of the issue, too, is having affordable type of housing.
Right.
And there is really a high demand for housing right here in the state of Hawaii and right here in our city and county of Honolulu. And we have to create more housing opportunities.
Absolutely.
For people. Now, with the new developments coming online and with what's being built in Kaka'ako, that does not keep up with the amount of housing we have to produce, as well as living wages. You know, that also has to
right.
come up too, and providing right. opportunities in terms of incentives for people, in terms of jobs. There are many of my friends who have left Hawaii or decided to come back home and be with family, but if they come back home, they're taking a pretty significant pay cut.
Well, I took very big pay cut when I came here. I took more than that. I'm making a third of what I was making in New York, and I consider myself very lucky, and I think I'm doing well, but I see that, you know, there are lots of service jobs, lots of low-paying jobs,
right.
that, those middle-income jobs are scarcer, the ones where you can buy a house, you can raise a family. Mm-hmm. They seem to be fewer. And further between than in some place like, say, New York.
Right, and that's important. We have to really look at that middle class and low income as well.
Right.
And ensure that they get those resources and opportunity, whether that may be housing or jobs that can provide for their families. I hear so many stories of people who are working two or three jobs, raising a family at the same
Absolutely.
Time, keeping up, or people who are encouraging their kids to go into private education, or private colleges, or colleges, and colleges are now expensive for
right.
higher education.
That's why we believe in free colleges. Well, that's why I support Bernie Sanders. I'm free to say that. He's not free to say that.
But, you know, it's these opportunities that we have to create for people living here in Hawaii. And it's interesting to see all this change throughout the years. And that's part of the reason why I ran for office, is because I want it to be a place that I can still remain here and get married here, raise a family, and my kids for their future kids and the next generation on and to really be here. And Hawaii truly is a special place.
It absolutely is. It absolutely is. I think it's a wonderful place for small businesses, too. I mean, there are so many inventive businesses, business people that I've met on this island and the other islands. And, you know, they sell, you know, herbs for restaurants, mm-hmm. or they make artisanal products. And I think it's a very vibrant sort of artistic and do-it-yourself kind of community. And if the cost of living was a little less, it'd be a little easier to encourage that kind of, experimentation, because it takes a certain amount of money in order to sustain yourself while you start a business or, you know.
Absolutely. Yeah. And there's also the hurdles that they have to go through for business owners to start their own business, you know, the permitting, whether they have, you know, our leasing agreements
extensive.
And
it's
all that, what they have to go through selling their products and really market themselves here locally.
It's extensive here, I have to say. I mean, even compared to New York, it's extensive. And I have a little bit of a feeling you have to really want to live here in order to live here, because I'll give you a small example. I had to retake the bar. Many jurisdictions, if you're admitted to the bar for a certain number of years, mm-hmm. you automatically are a lawyer in their jurisdiction, but not in Hawaii. Hawaii, you have to take the bar. So there's lots of little hurdles like mm-hmm. that you mm-hmm. have to jump through in order, if you wanted a food truck, let's say,
sure.
or whatever business is interested, you're interested in, there's lots of little bureaucratic red tape to get through. So
And you have to really want it, absolutely.
Yeah, well, you should take care of some of that bureaucratic red tape, Brandon. Get right on that. Fix that, your bureaucratic red tape. So, yeah. Why do you think that is? Do you think they want to protect the citizenry so much, or why do you think there's such this extensive permitting and licensing? Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. Or is it just historical?
I think it's a combination of both. I think over time you have these rules and policies and procedures in place, and now we're looking at what are some ways that we can streamline some areas. I mean, we always talk about streamlining and improving, and I think now it's so much more accessible to reach out, you know, to your elected officials. You know, I remember back in the 2008 election when President Obama was a candidate, and how he used social media to really engage
with
people.
It was revolutionary.
And how people really have come out of the masses. And just like you kind of see now and today. But we have to continue to keep people still interested.
Right.
There's a lot of people don't really have confidence in government.
Right.
And really, truly, government is kind of what runs a lot of things on a day-to-day basis.
Jay Fidel, you know, I talk about this constantly. We talk about... Why have people lost faith in large institutions like the government, like the church? I mean, they're innumerable. I read a very interesting book. It's called The Unwinding. And this guy says that, you know, because we have many more personal freedoms, we've given up a certain vested interest in these institutions. But these institutions are changing too, right?
Absolutely.
Along with us, you know? So, I mean, take gay marriage, for example. Mm-hmm. I mean, that was passed. You know, everybody, you know, at a certain point, everybody was like, that's a done deal. And, you know, something I'm very interested in, medical marijuana, I think that's going to change Hawaii tremendously. Mm-hmm. And I represented a medical marijuana dispensary. And... the states that are doing it, and particularly the states that have then proceeded to pass recreational marijuana laws, are producing a tremendous amount of revenue.
Mm-hmm.
Now, there's problems also, you know, with that, obviously. But I think this is a very exciting point in let's say the marijuana history of Hawaii. it's going to be very interesting for the next couple of years to see how these dispensaries fare and whether they're going to hand out more licenses and so on.
It will be. And also, too, what's very interesting with these large institutions is there's a lot of knowledge. Just in the city alone, there's very experienced people that check permits, building permits, and a lot of baby boomers who are retiring. and all that knowledge and whatever they can teach to their people that they're training is going out with them at
right.
the door.
Right.
So how do we fill that gap in between? And the new wave of generation, whether they may be Xers, Yers, or even millennials you
no,
find
sure.
working in government, have to play catch up and really learn that.
Right. There has to be programs in place for the passing of the torch. A couple of weeks ago, I had some people from the bar on, and they developed mm-hmm. a program really essentially for older lawyers to impart wisdom to younger lawyers
yes.
so there'd be a continuity. And that's one good thing about big institutions. There's a lot of institutional knowledge there.
Mm-hmm.
And there has to be programs or a protocol for passing that knowledge on. If not, a lot will be lost and
right.
people have to start it over again. That's a waste of the taxpayers'
yeah.
money, you
yeah.
know.
Succession planning is key.
Right, right, absolutely. But you know what? I think a little bit of a problem, and I say this as a baby boomer, is the baby boomers don't want to let go. Let go! No, we don't want to let go. But they have to let go and let, as you said, Gen X in, Gen Y, and you know, they've had so good for so long that it's time for a fresh viewpoint, I think.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
I think.
And
so.
There's a lot in common between millennials and boomers as well.
Absolutely.
We're talking briefly before coming mm-hmm. on the show and differences as well. It's like how do we work together for that same mission, that same thing
right.
that we want?
Well, there's certainly an environmental vision that's sort of mm-hmm. straight out of the 60s and even just The baby boom is the first generation that I can think of that was identified as a their own group of people, and millennials are like that too. They have their own world, their own network,
mm-hmm.
and because they were born into this kind of technology, a lot of older people don't understand the world. They don't
right.
they don't understand that yeah you know this person sitting at this coffee shop, that person's really working.
Mm-hmm.
They may be working in Bangkok,
right?
You know what I mean? Or they may be remotely working anywhere mm-hmm. in the world, but just because they're wearing t-shirt and jeans, you know, and sitting at Starbucks doesn't mean they're not working.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. Yeah.
So I think that's, so do you have flexibility in your office? I mean, can you work remotely, or are there mechanisms in place for people to work
yes,
remotely?
Yes, absolutely. And what a lot of people don't realize actually is when I tell people a city council, being a city council member is actually part-time on paper. It doesn't feel that way for me
right.
personally, because I think it's more than part-time
right.
Than just, you know, your standard 19, 20 hours or whatever it may be for it qualifies for part-time. It's going to night meetings. Last night we had a pro-city neighborhood board meeting. This Thursday we'll be having a Waipahu neighborhood board meeting, and it's all these different events. So there's flexibility, and I'm usually an early riser. I usually wake up about 5 a.m.
Me
in the
too.
Morning. Awesome.
Yeah,
and
you
get
can
a
get
good
a lot
start
done.
To the day, you can. You know,
right.
in those first 2-3 hours of the morning when everyone's starting to wake up, you can get a lot done. You know, go into the gym and, you know,
well,
get started with
I don't
your
know
day
about going
all.
To the gym, but can are there any appearances that you're going to be making that you would like to tell people? Obviously, you said Waipahu.
Waipahu is this Thursday. It's every fourth Thursday of the month.
Okay.
It's at the Filipino Community Center in
okay.
Waipahu.
Terrific.
So I'll be there at that, and as well as Memorial Day event. We're having Memorial Day coming up this weekend, and the city and county of Honolulu hosts a Memorial Day at Punch Bowl.
Excellent.
And that's at 8:30, and that's also welcome to the public as well, I believe.
Oh, terrific.
Yeah.
Okay, so that's a great note to end on. There's going to be a Memorial Day festival in Punch Bowl. I thank you so much. You're such a
You're welcome.
Special person, and I just feel so lucky to be able to talk to so many brilliant people that pass through these studios. My name is Maryann Sasaki. You're watching Life in the Law. We're on Wednesdays between 1 and 2 on thinktechhawaii.com. I hope you'll join us.